Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Completely Mad, Tom McClean, John Fairfax, and the Epic Race to Row Solo Across the Atlantic, by James R. Hansen. Narrated by Mitch Crawford. From the Apollo 11 Astronauts, to John Fairfax. May we of Apollo 11 add our sincere congratulations to the many you have undoubtedly already received for your bold and courageous feat of rowing alone across the Atlantic. We who sail what President Kennedy once called the new ocean of space are pleased to pay our respects to the man who, single-handedly, has conquered the still formidable ocean of water. We find it an interesting coincidence that you completed your arduous voyage here on Earth at a spot very near the one from which we started our voyage to the moon, and that you arrived at your destination quite near the time that we reached ours. Yours, however, was the accomplishment of one resourceful individual, while ours depended upon the help of thousands of dedicated workers in the United States and all over the world. As fellow explorers, we salute you on this great occasion. The Apollo 11 astronauts, Neil Armstrong, Michael Collins, Edwin A. Aldrin, Jr. Telegram from the Apollo 11 astronauts in quarantine inside the Lunar Receiving Laboratory at the Manned Spacecraft Center in Houston, Texas, to ocean rower John Fairfax, July 30, 1969. More than twice as many people have walked on the moon as have soloed the Atlantic Ocean in a rowboat. Statement from the Ocean Rowing Society International, 2019. The first ocean rows were done under conditions that were not much different from the days of Columbus. Jeff Allum, trustee of the Ocean Rowing Society International and cousin to Don Allum, 1937 to 1992, the first person to row the Atlantic in both directions, and still the only person to have rowed both ways solo. Prologue. This is not a true story. It is two true stories. Two true stories that have never been told as one, though they deserve to be. One sweeping saga involving two extraordinary and extraordinarily different adventurers, Tom McClean and John Fairfax, having only two things in common, the Atlantic Ocean and the ambition to cross it in a rowboat. Alone. Just one man, one small boat, and a pair of oars. They raced across the Atlantic solo during one of humankind's most epic years. It was 1969, and each rower finished his remarkable transoceanic journey within just a few days of the historic first landing on the moon by Apollo 11 on July 20. The two oarsmen took very different routes across the sea. McClean, a 26-year-old British paratrooper, set out from St. John's, Newfoundland, on May 17 and landed at Blacksod Bay on the remote northwest coast of Ireland on July 26. Moving from west to east, his crossing took 70 days. McLean's was the first solo row ever across the Atlantic in that direction. Fairfax, a 31-year-old prolific gambler, playboy, and former whiskey and gun smuggler, read pirate, had a head start, and he would need it. He left from San Augustine in the Canary Islands off the coast of Africa on January 20, 1969, and landed at Hollywood Beach north of Miami, Florida on July 19. Fairfax's east-to-west crossing took a torturous 180 days and was the first solo row crossing of the Atlantic in that direction. For both men, crossing the ocean meant thousands of miles of backbreaking effort, exhaustion, and bodily wear, tear, and injury. Vicious storms, gale winds, high waves, and sharks would all attack them. More than once, their rowboats capsized. Battered beyond belief, hands blistered and bloody, almost continuously soaked to the skin and fighting against mental and physical lethargy, both oarsmen rowed on, never seriously doubting a final success. What made the dogged determination of both men so incredible was the fact that neither man had any previous experience as an ocean rower, and McClean, worse yet, knew almost nothing about the sea or seamanship. He set off into the North Atlantic anyway. Completely Mad tells an intertwined story of the two astonishing journeys and the two uncommonly extraordinary men who were crazy enough to make them. What sort of person rows a boat solo across an ocean? Who would even consider taking on that sort of frightful and highly perilous challenge? Is it someone with a suicide wish? Is it a person out of balance mentally or emotionally? Is it a pure glory seeker? A daredevil? Is it a narcissist pining to be famous? Who possibly? Who in the world? As a research scholar specializing in aerospace history, I've learned a lot about people who risk their lives in perilous pursuits. I've spent 5 decades of my life studying in depth the lives of test pilots and astronauts. I am therefore quite familiar with the motivations of the rare breed of men and women whose driving passion is to fly experimental airplanes at great speeds, through fantastic maneuvers, to great heights, and ultimately even taking some of their craft to the edge of the atmosphere and beyond into space. I've studied their background stories, their personalities and their ambitions, as well as their mindsets, emotional dispositions, and psychologies, and I have come to understand how far some human beings, perhaps those with the ineffable right stuff, will push their bodies and minds, their capabilities, and their goals in order to pioneer epic expeditions into the unknown. I had the great good fortune of writing the authorized biography of just such a man, Neil Armstrong, First Man 2005, who, with his Apollo 11 crewmates Michael Collins and Buzz Aldrin, committed their flying careers and their very lives to an ultimate destination, a 500,000-mile trip from Earth to the moon and back. That sensational lunar goal was achieved not just at great cost to the nation, but, as we have found as we have delved more deeply over the years into the personal stories of the astronauts, also to themselves and their wives and children. After all, wasn't going to the moon the most dangerous mission of all time? I had always thought so until I thought about what it would take to row a boat solo across an ocean. Now, that sounded truly crazy. If given a choice of going to the moon with 2 other trained professionals, in a spacecraft as roomy as a large automobile, with a whole team of experts back at Mission Control in Houston overseeing virtually every step of the trip, or rowing a small boat across the Atlantic Ocean by myself, requiring as many as 24,000 oar strokes per day? Which would I choose? Hands down, I'm going to the moon. Were John Fairfax and Tom McClean mad? Were they actually suffering from some clinical condition? Certainly, a number of people back at the time, when John and Tom told them of their plan to row the Atlantic solo, said to them, "Alone? You're daft, man. You must be completely mad." This book offers no formal psychological study of John Fairfax or Tom McClean, as interesting as that might be. My son, Dr. Nathaniel Hansen, is an MD psychiatrist, but I am not. Although as part of my background research for this book, I reviewed a great deal of the scientific literature dealing with the psychology of mountain climbers, bullfighters, automobile racers, and participants in such extreme sports as free climbing, base jumping, volcano surfing, wingsuit flying, paraskiing, highlining, and other highly dangerous, physically hazardous, and life-threatening pursuits of athletic and human performance, I have made no serious attempt to make systematic use of any formal psychological theories in my analysis of the two men. Nonetheless, my book illuminates a great deal about the personalities and characters of Fairfax and McClean, as extremely different as the two men were, as close to the opposite ends of the human personality spectrum as two adventurers with the same incredible goal in mind could possibly be. It will not be in any theory of psychology, but in the actual words and deeds of Fairfax and McClean, that listeners will discern the emotional makeup, mental states and processes, thought patterns, drives and ambitions, motives for action, beliefs and values, ethics and egoisms, attitudes and prejudices, essence of intellect, sense of identity, moods and feelings, and emotional makeup of the story's two protagonists. By the end of the remarkable tale, listeners should feel that they have developed a good understanding of the highly contrasting nature of the two men who first crossed the Atlantic Ocean solo in a rowboat. And perhaps we will come to the understanding that it's not one particular type of person that takes these crazy risks and can do these amazing feats, but a strange confluence of traits and temperaments that sometimes, in certain combinations, yield a peculiar kind of magic. Of course, neither Fairfax nor McClean ever considered himself truly mad, though there were moments on the Atlantic when things were going so terribly for them that they were not so sure. Maybe they were a bit crazy for taking this on, they could occasionally admit to themselves, but both men were always determined, rather absolutely, to press on. The narrative penetrates deeply into who they were and what drove them to dare such an extreme, mortally risky endeavor. It explores not only what their extraordinary ocean crossings meant to the protagonists, but also what their individual journeys illuminate about them in high contrast as fundamentally different types of men. In this vein, there is also analysis of what their passages across the ocean and across life in general, signify about some of the male attitudes and masculine values that were prevalent in Western societies, for good or ill, during the middle decades of the 20th century. As I was immersed in the story of McClean and Fairfax, the Homeric nature of their stories became clear to me. Just as Odysseus was the subject in the center of Homer's great poem, The Odyssey, McClean and Fairfax are the alpha and the omega of this epic tale. Some commentators have called Odysseus the first modern man. Other scholars have labeled him the untypical hero. Similar rubrics can be applied to Tom McClean and, even more so, to John Fairfax. In responding to their call to adventure, both were self-assured and self-actuated. To achieve what they came to regard as the paramount mission of their early adulthood, that was, to battle past one's personal and local limitations, win a victory over nature, and prove mastery over oneself, thereby becoming a personage of not only local, but also world historical import, McClean and Fairfax pitted themselves, figuratively and literally, against a host of monsters, sirens, nymphs, angry gods, foreboding ill winds, screaming gales, mysterious murky mists, shark attacks, drownings, and collisions with passing ships. In their innate need to overcome such threatening and potentially deadly circumstances and emerge at their destinations victoriously, the two men were similar. But in virtually everything else about McClean and Fairfax and their common, yet so uncommon personal sagas, they could not have been more different. One of the book's clear conclusions is that Fairfax and McClean undertook their epic voyages for very different reasons. Reasons that flowed from who they were and what their lives up to the time of their great journey had made them. It is impossible to imagine two men who were seeking to do the same sort of crazy thing ever being more different than Fairfax and McLean, or how their two crossings of the Atlantic Ocean, occurring with virtual simultaneity in 1969, could have been of such tremendously different character. Impossible to imagine, that is, until one understands the deeply different social and cultural settings out of which the two men as boys and young men had developed their values and ambitions. During the writing of the book, in fact, I seriously considered using The Paratrooper and the Playboy as its title in order to feature the tremendous contrast between the two adventurers. In the end, I determined that Completely Mad was a better title to use, not to suggest any sort of clinical madness inherent to the two ocean rowers, but to capture the incredulous popular attitude of the general public when it came to individuals like Fairfax and McLean who attempted such extreme, mortally dangerous feats. What the title conveys as a colloquialism is the sense of amazement, awe, disbelief, and even borderline scorn that we human beings feel when we confront the audacious daring of such seemingly impossible challenges that only a few of our kind would ever venture to try. Whether that sense of skepticism of fantastic individual risk-taking and daring performance was stronger in Western society and culture 50 years ago than it is today is debatable and worthy of further study. But there is no question that most people who heard about the solo transatlantic rows of Fairfax and McLean in the summer of 1969 felt that both men had to be completely mad. Although not a race between them in any way official or declared, both men clearly committed their heart and soul to a solo ocean crossing with the idea of being the very first to do it. Otherwise, if they couldn't have been first, they would never have bothered to do it. Their two stories, as remarkably dramatic as they were individually, when woven into a tale of two men of deeply contrasting characters and divergent approaches, both making it alone across the Atlantic, rank as one of the most fascinating personality-driven adventure stories of all time. Historically, the race between Fairfax and McLean deserves to be remembered as another great saga of the year 1969, one of even more awesome individual daring and commitment than the monumental trip of astronauts Armstrong, Collins, and Aldrin across the vacuum of space to the moon. Part 1. Tom McClean and Super Silver. 1. Oars through the harbor. It was a long, smooth pull through the placid harbor waters. 26-year-old Irishman Tom McClean, all 5'6" of stoutness, bent his back in what was a not too regular rowing rhythm as he concentrated on getting a feel for his boat. He had dubbed his vessel Super Silver, the result of a deal of $1,000 from the Gillette UK company, which was launching a new razor by that name. Tom himself simply called his rowboat Silver. At this stage, the boat meant little more to McLean than a conglomeration of plywood, oak frame, nylon canvas, glue, and epoxy resin, from which came an assembly of hull, floors, planking, gunwales, oarlocks, and bows. It wasn't that he disliked his rowboat. He was unsure how well it would perform for him. How would the boat do in the rough open ocean? How would it stand up to the serious, even life-threatening challenges that were sure to come? Could Silver stand the strain? could it take him all the way home, the full 2,000-plus miles from Newfoundland to Ireland? He liked the look of his boat, but there was no reason yet to love it, and he didn't. It was 8:45 a.m., Saturday, May 17, 1969. Tom had wanted to be in the water with Silver at least 45 minutes earlier, but the large crowd of interested spectators and well-wishers on the quay at St. John's Harbor that weekend morning made a prompt departure impossible. "Half the world and his wife were there to see me go," Tom remembers. A conflux of maritime Canadians, estimated at over 200, had come down to the wharf to watch the chap, who they had heard accurately was an active-duty British soldier on leave from his commando unit, take off to cross the ocean in a rowboat. The onlookers applauded his arrival and cheered loudly as he made his way through them and down to his boat. One rascal handed him a girly magazine. "There you are, sir. That'll give you something to keep you heading for home." Making it down to the dock where Silver was tied up, a bearded man that Tom had every reason to think was a veteran fisherman handed Tom a bottle of whiskey. "Christen the boat with that," he shouted for all to hear. Immediately, Tom did just that, cracking the bottle and, in an act of ultimate sacrifice in a place where whiskey was currency, pouring out every last drop of the precious liquid over the bow. He answered a few questions asked by local newspaper reporters, and to please a local television cameraman, he made a fist and punched the air a few times with it. One man asked if he could have a picture taken with Tom and Silver, a request that, in his shyness and his hurry, Tom politely declined. Surrounded by folks, even teenagers, who knew quite a bit more about boats and being on and around the ocean than he did, because they had been born and bred into an intimate marriage with the sea, Tom suddenly felt terribly self-conscious. The people of coastal Newfoundland were among the very best boat builders, boat handlers, and fishermen in the entire world. Their proximity to the Grand Banks, a series of underwater plateaus southeast of the island of Newfoundland on the North American continental shelf, gave them ready access to one of the world's richest fishing grounds, supporting Atlantic cod, flounder, halibut, swordfish, haddock, redfish, capelin, pollock, and other so-called groundfish, as well as shellfish, seabirds, and sea mammals. For generations, the way of life, economy, and culture of Newfoundland and the other maritime provinces depended on the bounty of the sea. Mountains of shellfish were hauled in regularly by trawlers. Snow crab, shrimp, lobster, sea cucumbers, and scallops. Many a day, mackerel and herring filled up the fishermen's nets. Into the early 20th century, there had been whaling, and even into the 1960s, though increasingly controversial and to be outlawed by a number of national and international laws and treaties, there was a large-scale commercial harvesting of harp seals and other sea mammals, as well as the hunting of seabirds. Though Tom McClean chose to embark from Newfoundland primarily due to its location and the shorter distance across to Ireland from there, it was not at all irrelevant to him that the Newfoundlanders knew their boats, and they loved their boats. The type of boat that Tom was using for his Atlantic crossing was of their own special creation. One could even call it their pride and joy. The Newfoundland dory had been used as the traditional fishing boat on the Grand Banks since the early 19th century. The boat, also called the Banks dory, was a small, open, narrow, flat-bottomed and slab-sided boat with a particularly narrow transom and long overhangs at the bow and stern. It was a simple enough but extremely well-conceived design, perfected over the decades, that helped lift the boats over the waves. Inexpensive to build, the dories were stacked inside each other, some 30 to 40 of them, and stored on the deck of a larger fishing vessel, which functioned as a mothership. The dories were then lowered one at a time off the mothership, usually with one man per boat who was equipped with as many as 500 hooks with lines. The fishermen of Newfoundland would stay at sea for weeks at a time in all types of weather, going forth and back from the mothership. The heavier the dories became with loaded catch, up to about a half-ton limit, the more stable the dory actually became. The Newfoundlanders had forgotten more about dory operation than McClean could have possibly learned in the few months that he had been building and practicing in his. And Tom knew that the people of the wharf at St. John's knew it, and suspected that he knew that they knew. Tom's boat also was a dory, but it had been built in England, not Newfoundland. His was a Yorkshire dory. The Yorkshire dory was basically similar to the Newfoundland dory. Both featured a keelless design that enabled the dory to ride the sea rather than attempt to fight it. Built by Bradford Boat Services in West Yorkshire, the dory that was to become Tom's Silver was handcrafted from top-grade plywood on an oak frame. Its hull was covered in tough nylon canvas sheeting that was woven and glued onto the plywood with epoxy resin. The nylon sheathing made the exterior of the boat quite tough. If the boat took a big impact, it might crack the marine ply hull, but the nylon sheathing would stretch under impact rather than break, adding protection from the boat leaking. With the help of carpenters working at the army base in Hereford, where Tom was stationed, Tom altered the boat by having her gunwales raised 9 inches and by fitting turtle decking fore and aft over watertight compartments containing blocks of polystyrene for additional buoyancy. Turtle decking is a term applied to a weather deck that is rounded over from the shell of a boat so that it has a shape similar to the back of a turtle. The upper deck of the vessel thus has a pronounced curve from its center line down to the sides. The purpose of turtle decking is to assist overboard the flow of any seawater shipped over the bows. Fresh water in 2-gallon containers was placed under a false floor, protecting the water for drinking and additional ballast. There was no cabin, but Tom gave his boat a small canvas shelter stretched over a metal U-frame. Under the canopy, Tom left the space measuring 2 feet 7 inches at its highest center point, about 4 feet wide and 3 feet long. The space was not all for Tom and his food supply. It also served to shelter his chronometer, his radios, and an inflatable rubber dinghy loaned to Tom by the RAF. The sheltered space left for Tom himself gave him nowhere near the protection from the salt air and freezing cold that he hoped for. One touch of luxury that he intended for his trip was to sleep on an airbed that could be packed into the space, but that didn't work out nearly as well as he planned. "I had to lay it fore and after, leaving about 3 feet of my body sticking out in the open." His only choice was to make the best of it. In the preparation stage, Tom had not even thought of the possibility of frostbite attacking his feet, but attack it would, to the point where his feet were so swollen he couldn't wear his boots for days on end. In key respects, Tom's dory copied the design of the English Rose 3, the dory that in the summer of 1966 had taken his fellow British paratroopers John Ridgway and Che Blythe on their historic 2-man crossing of the Atlantic, though at 18 feet, Silver would be 2 feet shorter. It was the ocean crossing of English Rose 3 by Ridgway and Blythe that first gave Tom the notion that a person could row the Atlantic solo. A crazy notion for anyone, but especially for someone who, at the time the idea hit, had not only done 0 ocean rowing, but had hardly done any kind of rowing at all. Though the two boat types were similar, the experienced Newfoundlanders could quickly spot the differences between Tom's dory and their own. The hulls weighed much the same, but the Newfoundland dory was made of wide boards of wood and was a completely open boat with no turtle decks holding buoyancy compartments. Regarding the raised deck and gunwales reinforced with oak, they could see what Tom had done to substantially beef up his dory for the ocean crossing, and rightfully so. Their own dories, because they needed to be launched and retrieved from the mothership many times between fishing trips, needed to be kept as basic and lightweight as possible. As curious as the crowd on St. John's Quay was, picking out and conversing among themselves about the special features of Tom's dory, they were even more curious to learn how such a barmy British soldier and inexperienced seaman would handle his boat. That was certainly what the majority of the local fishermen were waiting to see. None of them had yet witnessed him row a single stroke. The only rowing that this trooper had done after he got to St. John's via an RAF transport from England was at dusk the previous evening when, Tom made sure, nobody was around. And then all he did was move Silver a few yards from one side of the dock to the other side of the dock, readying it to head off in the morning. Sensing Tom's nervousness, several people in the crowd, men, women, and children, shouted out what they believed to be vital last-minute pieces of advice. "Our Newfoundland has miles of tricky coastline, be warned. You have to watch for the drawl of the land, young man. It's a compelling force that will try to drag you back and dash you against our jagged rocks. Once you're through those narrows, son, keep pulling. Get away from that coast. Don't stop rowing until the land is out of sight. Sailors want wind, sir. Rowers don't. Why didn't you give yourself a sliding seat? That way you could put more of your back and abdomen into your strokes and not so much into your arms. Don't grip your oars too tight, not even in strong winds or big waves. That'll tire out your hands and body more than anything. Stay relaxed and calm, even in the fiercest winds. Don't ever get scared out there, boy. If you do, you're a goner. Feel the water on each blade of your oar. In difficult seas, you only control the boat when the blades of your oars are in the water. In rough seas, don't use long strokes. Shorten your stroke by a quarter to a half. If you work your way upwind of your mark, turn to take the waves on the stern quarter. A zigzag course will avoid settling into the trough. You'll be lucky, lad, to make it through the Labrador Current. Watch for icebergs. There's likely to be a few out there. Don't go into the water unless you absolutely have to, young man. It's damned cold, and the fog can be so bad you might never see your boat again. The foggiest place in the world is the Grand Banks. You can count on the weather being treacherous. It almost always is in the Banks. A lot of that advice seemed pretty solid to McClean, but it was not the time for a course in Newfoundlander boating wisdom. Looking at his watch, Tom said to the crowd, "Well, it's no good hanging around. I might as well start now so that at least I'll be out of the harbor by dark." That wisecrack got laughter all around. It helped Tom to relax. Scanning the wharf, he saw some friends he had made in the few short days he had been in St. John's. There was Jack Robbins, an officer with the Royal Canadian Mounted Police, who had allowed Tom to stay in the Mounties' barracks, enjoy the freedom of the mess hall, and showed him some of the sights around the city, including a trip up to the old tower on Signal Hill, overlooking the entrance to the harbor from where radio pioneer Guglielmo Marconi had transmitted the world's first transatlantic cable message in 1907. Tom also picked out the unmistakable head of Big Ed Geddon, the man from Furnace Withy, the firm that had received shipment of silver in St. John's, who had watched every minute of the loading of Tom's dory like a hawk. Big Ed had come quayside two or three times a day to run a casually expert eye over Silver and deliver his verdict. On one of those visits, Ed had growled, "Where are your gloves?" Tom showed him two pairs, one woolen and the other leather. "Useless," Ed rumbled. "You might as well have none in that cold out there. What you need is Portuguese fishermen's gloves, wool soaked in cod oil, used out on the banks. They last forever, and when you get them wet, just wring them out, put them back on, and they'll still keep your hands warm." A half hour later, Big Ed was back with a pair of Portuguese mittens. Tom still uses that same pair to this day. Tom also spotted the three teenage boys who had run up to him on the docks and who wouldn't rest until I allowed them to help me. In a biting wind, the boys, Patrick, Harold, and George, helped Tom load and stow all his stores in the various nooks and crannies of the boat as if their lives depended on it. Even in St. John's, it was thought that there should be a guard on such a vulnerable boat at night. Tom told the boys that he would sleep aboard, but the kids would hear nothing of that. "I needed all the sleep I could get," they insisted. The teens mounted two-hour watches, one of them dashing home to get an air pistol. The Mounties even got into the act, asking the boys in the early dawn what they were up to and ensuring they were about legal business. Such was the spirit of the place, Tom reflects fondly. And, of course, standing close by and with tears brimming in their eyes were the members of the Squire's family. Jack the Mountie had introduced Tom to them at a church service. Husband Harold, a local civil servant, his wife Jean, and children Elizabeth, Robin, Anne, Jeannie, and David. Being an orphan from infancy and living in an orphanage until age 15 and in the care of that orphanage until age 17 and a half when he joined the British Army, Tom had benefited only a couple times in his life from anything like genuine family life. But in the short time they had known each other, the Squire's family took in Tom like he was one of them. The night before he left for his Atlantic crossing, Jean Squires had prepared an enormous going-away dinner for Tom, which I literally wolfed down. David Squires, 12 years old, asked Tom how he felt about taking on the ocean. "Just like I did before a parachute jump," said the paratrooper. "What are the chances you could die from jumping in a parachute?" queried David. "We were told in the parachute regiment that there was a 4-to-1 chance of surviving our first jump unscathed," Tom answered. "Those are pretty good odds, huh?" said David. "I imagine the chances of your making it all the way across the ocean are a lot worse." "Well, we'll see," was all the trooper managed to answer. Tom slept that night at the squire's home. For breakfast, they fed him an enormous meal of eggs, bacon, and toast. Tom drank 3 huge cups of tea. The squire's family was truly sad to see him go. Before leaving the house, Jean gave him a flask of tea and a large batch of sandwiches. It looked enough to last a month. On the quay, again spotting Jack the Mountie, Tom couldn't help but notice the special caring look the splendid policeman was giving him. Tom thought back to the church service Jack had insisted that he attend with him. "Me? Church?" Tom had thought to himself. The orphanage had choked virtually all traces of formal religious belief out of him. At first, Tom made the excuse that he had not packed a formal shirt or suit and therefore was not fit for going to church.
"No problem," replied Jack. "We can find clothes at the barracks that should fit you."
At 5'6", Tom doubted that. Most of the Mounties were close to 6 feet or taller. But Jack found a man who was just 2 inches taller than Tom. The jacket was long, the trousers had to be rolled up at the ankles, and the shirt covered Tom almost to his knees, ballooning around him like an air-filled tent. The shoes were very tight. All kitted out, Tom deserved the good-natured grin that Jack gave him. But Jack gave him no choice. He figured that a man who was going to leave in the morning to row a boat across the ocean bloody well ought to pray. And in church, Tom, the apostate, did pray. It was a prayer for God to let him get on his way. "Let go the mooring lines," Tom finally was able to shout at 8:45 a.m., a little louder than he intended. Tom, inside Silver, was more than ready to leave, to take on the monumental challenge he had chosen for himself. A dozen strokes of his oars through the harbor, McClean looked around for the last time. "There were a few sad eyes amongst that crowd," Tom recalls, but he noted even more the grave worry etched on their faces, very concerned for his fate. "I'll never forget all those watching faces as I rowed out for the open sea. No question that many of them thought they were watching the departure of a man who would never see land again. Many of them also thought that the man leaving in that boat was completely mad." Shrugging off the shivers, Tom told himself, "Well, we'll just have to wait and see. One thing for sure, I'll find out before they do." 2. Blow Me East. McClean headed for the Narrows, the immediate exit from St. John's Harbor to the Atlantic Ocean. On each side of the tight channel, heavy, dark cliffs lowered themselves to sea level and became a huge jumble of jagged rocks. Around them, the water foamed and swirled, breaking each striking wave into angry clouds of white spray before dividing and skittering back, as if trying to rejoin the receding swell. Newfoundland had miles of coastline like this. Tom had been warned about it. Old fishermen who had risked their lives for years around these shores had cautioned him about what they called the draw of the land, an all-compelling force that tried to drag you back, to dash you in savage triumph on those treacherous rocks. Still with Tom was a small flotilla, about 8 in all, of fishing launches, which kept company with him into the open sea. Some boats were carrying reporters and TV cameras. Others were carrying the plainly curious. Except for the sound of the chugging engines of their boats, they too were silent. To Tom, they all looked so bloody gloomy. He stopped rowing just long enough to give the nearest boat a wave and yell, "Cheer up! You're not going all the way like I am!" A raised hand or two in response was the only answer. Not until months later did Tom discover that his rowing style was the cause of their gloom. "He's digging his oars too deep. His hands are too close together. Holy cow, he won't clear land by next weekend, not rowing like that." Tom was only too glad he did not hear all the muttered comments. He didn't need anyone telling him that he was a raw novice when it came to handling boats. "I had long ago made up my mind that what I didn't know I would just have to learn, on the spot, when it counted most. Believe me, the will to survive is a powerful tutor. In any case, I would rather have sunk like a stone there and then than ever think of turning back." Then he was through the Narrows and in the open sea at last. Silver was grabbed by a huge twisting swell. She slewed and rolled in uncontrollable, ponderous, lurching movements like a bucking bronco trying to unseat its rider in slow motion. Each gunwale dipped in laborious, seemingly never-ending arcs as she heeled from side to side. Tom was pulling with all his strength with both oars in the water, but making no headway at all. Silver seemed to stop dead as the incoming swell tipped her bows skyward and tried to slide her backward into the bottom of the trough from which she had just climbed. Within seconds, the next swell swung the dory around almost broadside onto the incoming water, leaving Tom with the impression of trying to row along the side of a hill with one oar jammed in the ground, the other waving aimlessly in the air. Tom was somewhat stunned that he didn't seem to be getting much help from the outgoing tide. He had left St. John's on the turn of the tide, intent on dragging every ounce of advantage from it to get beyond the rocky coastline. Instead, he felt as if he was fighting an incoming tide all the way. It seemed a hell of a way to start my grand adventure. I felt quite a clown. Sweat poured off him as he wrestled to keep silver on as even a course as possible. Before starting, he had donned a thick woolen shirt, two sweaters, jeans, and a suit of oilskins. Although the sun was bright in a cloudless sky, the temperature at St. John's had only been 43 degrees Fahrenheit, 11 degrees above freezing. Now he was dripping. Each lurching movement of his boat had his body, from the haunches up, twisting from side to side and backward and forward in a continuous pendulum movement, while the muscles in his legs became rock hard with tension as he braced them against the floorboards. Just 3/4 of an hour out, and already one of Tom's pet schemes to provide himself with a spot of comfort was crumbling. Before leaving, he had combed the shops at St. John's to find a wedge-shaped plastic cushion to lash to his thwart. Thwart is the nautical term for the transverse seat across a boat stretching from gunwale to gunwale. Now he knew it was no good. It had me sitting too high, leaving me with the sensation that I was squatting above the level of the gunwales with a bird's-eye view of the water. The real trouble, however, was that no matter how tightly it was lashed, there was still movement. Silver would roll one way, the cushion another, and his body yet another. It was no good. It would have to go. I would just have to squat on hardwood all the way. Tom stopped rowing long enough to lash the cushion, throw it into his little shelter, and strip down to shirt and jeans. He told Silver, "Now, let's get down to it." Gradually, things began to go right. The wind, which had been northwest when he set out, swung around to the west, letting him get used to his boat's movement. At last, I felt as if I belonged to her and she to me. I actually felt we were moving as one, slow, but moving in the right direction, east. 8 or 10 miles out, the accompanying boats began turning back to St. John's. One by one, they circled Tom, and their occupants shouted, "Good luck," and headed for home. The paratrooper-turned-ocean rower watched as they rolled off in the swell. Sliding into trough after trough of the sea, they disappeared from sight until the next swell carried them into view again like some wild conjuring trick. As they bobbed up and down, Tom realized that he must be presenting exactly the same picture to them. In a short time, there was only one boat left, a man alone in his launch. Tom saw that it was Bob Ivory, a St. John's carpenter who had kindly helped to put the final touches on Silver's woodwork before putting her into the water. Ivory waved, then he too turned for harbor. It was a full 5 minutes before Tom realized he had stopped rowing to watch Bob motor away. Tom shook himself and got on with what he was out there to do. Row. Alone at last? Not quite. About half an hour later, a frigate of the Royal Canadian Navy steamed past Tom about 100 yards off his port side. They clearly knew what Tom was doing there. The lads lined the rails to wave, and the wind carried the tail end of their shouts to me, but I could not make out what they were saying. Then, with a breezy toot-toot-toot of her siren, the ship headed north on what Tom supposed was ice patrol. He rowed until 4 o'clock in the afternoon. He could still see what he thought was the outline of land, but he figured he was far enough now to be reasonably safe from coastal hazards. He poured tea from the flask Jean Squires had given him and munched steadily through the great pile of sandwiches she had made. I was happy to find that my appetite had not been affected in any way at all. I had thought I might be sick, but luckily there had not been the slightest sign of queasiness. Sipping the tea, he stared out at the fading daylight and took stock of the situation. The sea was getting rougher. Silver was beginning to be thrown about a bit, and the temperature had dropped to 40 degrees Fahrenheit. The wind had swung around yet again and was driving the dory south. Tom decided the best thing to do was put out the sea anchor and get his head down. A sea anchor is a device whose principle is to stabilize a boat and limit its progress through the water. It's not actually an anchor. It is more of a drogue or drag device. Rather than tethering a boat to a seabed, which is impossible for a small boat at typical ocean depth, the sea anchor provides a bridling system, providing drag, thereby acting as a brake. The sea anchor, sometimes called a para-anchor, can be used for various good purposes. It can prevent a vessel from turning broadside to the waves and being overwhelmed by them. It can help to stop a boat. It can stop a boat from turning into an unstable position. It can help a boat ride out a storm. It can help control drift. It can stabilize a boat for repair work and pumping out operations. It can give the boatman, especially needed if he is a rower, a timeout, the chance to get some rest. And it can help a boat make a safer landfall. Modern sea anchors are usually made of synthetic fiber or cloth, shaped like a cone or small parachute, and rigged so that the wider end of the anchor leads while its narrower end trails. When deployed, the sea anchor floats just under the surface, and the water moving past the sea anchor keeps it filled. It was 5 o'clock in the morning before Tom opened his eyes again. He was sick. I thought it would overtake me, but I didn't know whether it was seasickness or just a result of the built-up excitement of the last couple of days. He draped himself over Silver's side and hung there until he felt empty. Finally managing to lift his head, he stared across the sea through streaming wet eyes. Something seemed to be missing. At first he couldn't understand what it was. Then light dawned. The land was completely out of sight. His bout of sickness was only the beginning of the alarming initiation ceremony to the discomforts of the Atlantic. A slight pricking feeling spread across the palms of his hands. As the hours passed, each stroke of the oar seared into his hands as if the skin was wearing paper thin. Then the blisters began to balloon. There were three on the palm of each hand. He could feel them growing larger as he rowed. By midday, they were so swollen that the handles of the oars felt as if they had doubled in thickness. Tom could hardly clasp his fingers round them. Some drastic first aid treatment was called for. I bit through each blister in turn, carefully nicking a hole as near the middle as possible with the corners of my eye teeth, then squeezed out as much water as I could. Then I plunged my hands in and out of a bucket of water several times to try to pickle the dead skin into some state of firmness in order to protect the patches of raw flesh underneath. His hands stung like the blazes, but at least the oars felt normal size once more. Monday morning, May 19. Tom woke just after dawn to below freezing temperatures and Silver covered from stem to stern with a layer of thick frost. He sat up with the sleeping bag tucked tightly under his chin and, pulling aside the canvas front of his little shelter, looked around Silver as she glistened in the dull morning light. In Tom's recollection, it was like sitting in the middle of a birthday cake. Enveloped in a slight fog, Tom wondered where he could be. He had not yet bothered to fix a position and decided to let it slide for another day or two. His compass told him he was heading east, and that was all that mattered for the moment. He sat for a while with Silver rocking gently in a 10-mile-per-hour breeze. In the distance to the north, he spotted a couple of whales, but either they did not see him or considered him and his little boat unworthy of their attention, for they kept going on their chosen course until they vanished from sight. It was a lonely day, the first of many. Tom saw no ships, no birds, no planes. There was, however, a brush with domesticity that was quite out of touch with Tom's ocean adventure. A child's plastic potty came drifting past, bright yellow. He watched it as it bobbed away into the distance and pondered that, out in the middle of the Atlantic, the big event of the day can very well be seeing some totally unexpected, incongruous, and otherwise everyday object. As he rode, he kept thinking about that yellow potty. Where could it have come from? How old was the child? A boy or a girl? What sort of home was he or she growing up in? They were natural questions for a person to ask who had grown up an orphan. There was little time for reverie. The strongest winds he had yet experienced had been building up through the night. The wind whipped through the locking holes in the telescopic radio, its aerial whistling like a demented steam kettle. The most Tom managed was an extremely erratic session of catnaps. For the first time, Silver was being really knocked about. The sea thudded into her, shaking her so much that the vibrations didn't have time to fade away before the next lot of water attacked. She spun, bounced, and rocked. Waves broke over her every 15 to 20 minutes, huge waves, each one loading flimsy little Silver with somewhere near 40 gallons of water. That night was a living nightmare. It was pitch black, relieved occasionally only by the slight illumination afforded by the swirling phosphorus shining a ghost-like green on the water. That was the only means Tom had of visually checking the level of water inside the dory and deciding when to pump. He completely lost count of the number of times he crawled out of his shelter to go to work on those pumps. Finally, he just kneeled on his bundled-up sleeping bag in the shelter entrance, holding the pump handles and ready to pump at a moment's notice. Never did a night seem so long. Tom now propped himself up, his chest heaving with the effort of pumping. The blood tingled as it raced through his arms. His overheated body felt as if it was steaming against the bitter night air. Hours later, or so it seemed, a faint, moody gray light appeared around Tom. It came from the walls of ocean waves, topped with white fury, racing toward him and becoming visible against the sky. Not until dawn arrived was Tom able to see exactly what was happening. It was a toss-up whether or not he would welcome a freak of nature that could plunge him back beneath the cover of the ink-black night. This was his first taste of what he came to know as the Atlantic's favorite sport, playing squash with the smallest boat it could find. Tom had been a physical person all his life, relying mainly on his strength and willpower to cope with whatever situation came his way. But this was something he had no experience with. Never had he felt quite so utterly helpless. Silver was in the grip of winds of at least 50 miles per hour, and Tom said there was absolutely nothing I could do except pump for my life. Rolling toward him, under him, over him, and past him were 40-foot-high waves, a never-ending avalanche of water. Awesome. Unnerving, terrifying, it was all that and more. Yet the strongest feeling Tom had was that of being hypnotized by this fantastic show of nature's power. "I wasn't exactly frightened," Tom relates, "but I reckon I would have become well and truly scared if I had sat there too long just looking at the sea. The extraordinary thing was the difficulty I had in forcing myself not to look. Those heaving, rushing waters dragged at his eyes like a magnet." Foolishly, he decided that if he tried rowing for a bit, his mind would be too fully occupied to worry about the sea, and he would find welcome relief in the pure physical effort. For nearly an hour, he pushed himself in this futile and frantically unequal contest of man against the sea. Twice, probably the only times the oars really entered the water, Tom was within an ace of having the oars snatched from his grasp. He became obsessed with the idea that to lose one oar would be a disgrace, but to lose both, that would stamp him as an idiot, even though Silver carried two extra pair. He shipped the oars, that was, placed them in their rowlocks, and lashed them down as tightly as he could. "I imagine a more experienced seafarer would never have bothered in the first place," concedes Tom. "He would wisely have conserved his energy rather than expend it in such a useless manner." For the first time, Tom began to realize what was meant by the term seamanship. Yet, he wondered, what more could the best sailor in the world have done? The answer would surely be nothing more than wedge himself in the bottom of Silver, wait, and hope for the best. He was beginning to learn. Silver was now running before the wind. She was fairly zipping along and, with a following wind, was not taking nearly so much water inboard. But it was a wind from the north, driving Tom hard to the south and far off his eastward course. He cursed the unfriendly wind. "If you have to blow me east," he yelled into the storm as he watched his compass needle quivering relentlessly toward the south. He bitterly resented every yard that was off his eastward coast. For every yard would have to be regained, fought for, and bought back. And the price he would have to pay would be time, invaluable time. Every yard was a knife thrust to his ambition to be the first person to row the Atlantic single-handed. Every yard was a bonus to John Fairfax, somewhere far to the south of him. Part 2. John Fairfax and Britannia. 3. Betting on the Trades. By the time Tom McClean and his Silver left St. John's Harbor on May 17, 1969, and entered the open sea, John Fairfax in Britannia had already been in the Atlantic for 117 days. One would think that, in terms of there being any sort of race between McClean and Fairfax to cross the Atlantic first, Fairfax would be the hands-down winner. After all, McClean estimated that it could take him 100 days to row the North Atlantic from Newfoundland to the British Isles, meaning an arrival in late August. At the very best, he felt he might make landfall in Ireland in 70 days, resulting in an arrival in late July. But crossing the ocean, any ocean, was a very chancy thing. Without warning or apparent cause, any one of thousands of things could go wrong with the boat, with the rower, with the weather, with the winds, with the current, with the supplies, and likely would go wrong, individually or in cursed combination, multiple times, no matter what sort of vessel and how well designed, let alone a rowboat. There was absolutely no certainty that Fairfax would make it across the Atlantic successfully, or that McClean himself would manage it, no matter how willful and determined each man was. Plus, Fairfax had a long way to go, much farther than McClean. Originally, Fairfax had planned to row from Newfoundland to England. That was his intention in April 1968, when he first got truly serious about making the voyage. Given all the preparations that would need to be made, the timetable was very strict. The latest he could start and then have 3 months of fairly steady westerly winds was June. After that, according to the Atlas of Pilot Charts, the winds would become more and more variable, increasingly coming from the east and northeast. To start from scratch and be ready in 3 months' time, Fairfax came to understand, was a forlorn hope. But waiting a whole year until June 1969 was for him an unbearable thought. Fairfax committed to an alternative plan. instead of crossing the Atlantic from west to east, thereby taking the shortest route possible involving a launch from Newfoundland, he would row east to west, from the Canary Islands to Florida. It was a much longer route, nearly 4,000 miles as the crow flies, and likely a few hundred miles more than that in actual navigation. That was twice as far as Newfoundland to the British Isles, which was roughly 2,000 miles. Once committed to the alternative, John took delight in how the new scheme double-dared him. The disadvantage was obvious, but so was the challenge. After all, nobody had ever tried to row that way, and I would become not only the first person to row the Atlantic single-handed, but the first to do it from east to west. His alternative routing actually made a great deal of sense. First and foremost, he could make his departure from the Canary Islands the coming January, in the middle of winter, rather than waiting six more months. The island of Gran Canary, located in the archipelago 93 miles off the northwest coast of Africa, enjoyed mild winter weather. In January, a mean temperature of 64.2 degrees Fahrenheit, with 184 days of mostly sunshine and a mere inch of monthly rainfall. Gran Canary also had some great resorts with long beaches, dunes of white sand, and great Spanish food. Always a fan of the good life, John liked the idea of spending a few days at a comfortable resort, relaxing and sunbathing with his girlfriend prior to starting his trip. Fairfax's girlfriend was 21-year-old Sylvia Cook, born 1947. Much more will be written about her later in this chapter and throughout the book, as she plays a major role in Fairfax's story. Besides, the island's capital city, Las Palmas, as well as being famous for its annual carnival, had been the first stop of Christopher Columbus's expedition on his way back from the Americas in 1492. John liked the symmetry of that. Christopher Columbus and John Fairfax in the same sentence. It was not just that the jumping-off point would have nice weather. So would the route of the entire trip, at least in theory. Traveling at latitudes that were generally 25 to 35 degrees to the south of the Newfoundland route, Fairfax could rightfully expect his weather and sea surface temperatures to be considerably warmer. Although ocean temperature is affected by a number of factors, including air masses in the atmosphere, winds, currents, and depth of the water, latitude is the primary factor, with the temperature of the surface water gradually decreasing from the equator toward the pole at a rate of 0.5 degrees Fahrenheit per degree of latitude. A 35-degree difference in latitude between Fairfax's Canary Island route and the Newfoundland route could thus be expected to produce a difference in water temperature of 17 to 18 degrees. In terms of latitude, Miami was 100 miles south of Gran Canary, so John would not be taking Britannia northward except for some possible navigational adjustments. In the month of January, the difference between John's southern route and the Newfoundland route, in terms of surface water temperature, could be as much as 30 degrees. No frosty seas or icebergs for him. The difference in air temperature would be even greater. All considered, crossing the Atlantic from the Canaries should make the experience significantly more pleasant for the rower and a great deal more accommodating for the boat, all the equipment and supplies, and everything else involved. Should being the operative word. An ostensibly even greater advantage of the southerly routing was the way it would take advantage of the trade winds, or trades. The trades had been the driving force for sailing across the Atlantic ever since the Portuguese and Spanish began plying the ocean in the 15th century. Put simply, Earth's rotation causes air to slant toward the equator in a southwesterly direction in the northern hemisphere and a northwesterly direction in the southern hemisphere. Expressed conversely, this Coriolis effect, in combination with zones of high pressure, causes the trade winds to blow mainly from the northeast in the northern hemisphere and from the southeast in the southern hemisphere. The rotation of Earth deflects the atmosphere, resulting in curved wind paths. This deflection, called the Coriolis effect, sets up the complex global wind patterns that drive surface ocean currents. It is named after the French mathematician Gaspard Gustave de Coriolis, 1792 to 1843, who studied water wheels to understand the transfer of energy in rotating systems. The trade winds prevail only in a zone from about 30 degrees north to about 30 degrees south of the equator. Get outside of that 60-degree belt of latitude, sometimes called the horse latitudes, and the trade winds vanish. Known to sailors around the world, the trade winds and associated ocean currents have helped ships sail from European and African ports to the Americas for over 500 years. Likewise, the trades have hastened ocean voyages from the Americas toward Asia. By starting his crossing on Grand Canary Island and heading west, Fairfax's plan was to get as quickly as possible into the prevailing westward-driving action of the Atlantic trade winds. For Britannia, that would mean being carried along nicely, most of the time, with the breeze. For Fairfax, it meant he shouldn't be undergoing the torture of rowing against strong headwinds. Shouldn't, this time, being the operative word. Unfortunately, the operational dynamics of the world's winds are not that simple or reliable, and certainly not always predictable, not even the trades. In the ocean route westward that Fairfax proposed to make from the Canary Islands, he might easily encounter cold fronts, squalls, storms, and the effects of such nebulous phenomena as wind shadows and acceleration zones, which extend a long way from the Canaries and can foul up the considered plans of even the best prepared mariner. Leaving the Canary Islands, the wind blowing from the northeast is not always as stable in force and in direction as many sailors believe. There are mountains on the Canary Islands that reach as high as 3,700 meters, over 12,000 feet. The snow-covered peak of the Tide volcano on the island of Tenerife stands 3,718 meters, 12,198 feet high. The wind has to bypass these great heights, either by passing above or around the sides of the islands. Such a flow of air mass creates disturbances that modern meteorologists can spot quite well on pictures from satellites. The disturbances can include wind shadows of light yet contrary winds, as well as acceleration zones between the islands. Today's yachtsmen and skippers try to pass a long way from the Canaries to avoid these big wind shadows, which are followed by strong accelerations. Much has been learned about such anomalies since 1969. Certainly, John Fairfax was completely unaware of them when he launched his crossing from Las Palmas in January of that year. Not even professional meteorologists understood these phenomena very well. Fairfax himself was completely unaware of them when he launched his rowboat into the Atlantic from Gran Canaria on January 20, 1969. In addition, his rowboat, Britannia, was a Fairfax advantage. Designed by renowned naval architect Uffa Fox, England's leading and, at age 69, most experienced designer of small boats and Prince Philip's yachting companion, Britannia was a superior vessel, absolutely the best rowboat money could buy. Before Uffa Fox was recommended to him, Fairfax had never heard of him, an indication of how unconnected John was to British seamanship generally when, in late 1966, he first started contemplating his solo trip across the Atlantic. Fox was suggested to Fairfax by the London correspondent of an Argentine daily paper, George Marin. As we shall see in a later chapter, though born of an English father and a Bulgarian mother, Fairfax was born in Rome, Italy, and grew up in Buenos Aires, Argentina. Following up on Marin's advice, Fairfax sought Fox out at the London Boat Show held annually at Earl's Court Exhibition Center in Kensington. Fairfax recalled that first meeting. As was to be expected, Fox was dispensing advice to a crowd of boat lovers on one of the technical stands. I wanted to talk to him alone, so hung about for a while, summing him up. To beat around the bush with a man like Uffa would have been a serious mistake. So the moment he was left alone, I introduced myself and told him straight away that I had the intention of attempting to become the first man to row the Atlantic single-handed, had come far to do it, had no money and no boat, and would he help? How I went about it, I cannot remember, but I do remember the general feeling of dry emptiness, with the tingling of cold sweat somewhere along my back as I finished and braced myself for the inevitable question I knew would come. Why did I want to do it? A question I would not, could not answer. Not then or there. With a tinge of scorn which set my blood on fire, he asked, "Row the Atlantic single-handed, eh? And what on earth makes you think you could do it, my boy?" Gripping the edge of the table so hard it hurt, I leaned forward and told him, "Mr. Fox, I don't need the earth to tell me what I can do. I know." He frowned, and for a second or two, as he stared at me without batting an eyelid, a glimmer of ice replaced the naughty sparkle in his eyes, and I had a glimpse, behind the benevolent facade, of the steel the man was made of. A second or two, and the flicker of mischievous amusement reappeared, with a huge smile and a sea of wrinkles in the weather-beaten face. He slammed his fist on the table and said, "Right, I know exactly what kind of boat you will need, and I will design her for you." Fairfax, Britannia, 24. It took a few months, but Fox kept his promise, sending him a long letter dated March 20, 1967, describing the design of what became Britannia, including detailed blueprints and a sketch of what the boat would look like. It took even longer for Fairfax to arrange for Fox to be paid for his design and for the boat to be built by Wilf Souter of Cowes, England, and paid for. Ultimately, payment for both was provided by a banknote from one of the major sponsors for Fairfax's expedition, Yorkshire businessman Martin Cowling. It incorporated a number of advanced features. Notably, the boat was self-righting, a major attribute that Fox adapted from his earlier pioneering design of a self-righting lifeboat. Indeed, during sea trials, Britannia proved that if capsized, she could right herself in 2 seconds. The boat was also self-bailing. If swamped, she was dry in 30 seconds, the water sluicing down self-bailing slots almost as fast as the eye could follow. She was also highly stable. 2 men could stand on her gunwale and Britannia would only tilt a few inches. In turn, the boat was extremely durable. Rather than being constructed from simple oak planking, Britannia was made of a molded marine-grade double-diagonal mahogany, which was also resistant to rot and mold. 2, she featured a protective covering for the pilot and for storage of equipment and supplies. At a length of 24 feet, she was relatively commodious. McLean's boat was 20 feet long. Furthermore, Fox replaced the traditional fixed seat with a sliding seat, a feature now common to all modern ocean rowing boats, which allowed the rower to work more efficiently. In its glistening coat of fluorescent orange paint, Britannia was a strikingly beautiful boat, an elegant combination of form and function. Although his feelings about the boat would grow ambivalent after encountering difficulties while crossing the ocean, Fairfax initially found Britannia easy to handle and a pleasure to row. Before leaving from Grand Canary, he told reporters, I could take such a boat to hell and back without either of us being the worse for it. In preparing for his expedition, Fairfax benefited from the help of other experts. One of them was Archie de Jong, a developmental physicist, i.e. nutrition expert at Horlicks, a long-established British manufacturer of various powdered and dehydrated foods, ranging from its flagship malted milk to instant noodles, confectionery, and breakfast cereal. With Horlicks, Archie de Jong had provisioned a number of polar and desert exhibitions and most recently had helped supply food for the tragic attempt by London journalists David Johnstone and John Hoare in the summer of 1966 to row the Atlantic. Fairfax was not without his superstitions, and Horlicks' involvement with the Johnstone and Hoare disaster was nearly enough for John to reject their food. But being offered a plentiful supply of it free of charge in return for the publicity changed his mind. De Jong calculated that Fairfax would need 3,600 calories a day to stay fit. Horlicks packaged the rations in 100 individually sealed plastic bags, each weighing 2.5 pounds, for a total of 250 pounds. One package contained a day's full ration, a hot breakfast, a cold snack, and a hot main meal. The food required little preparation, and all of it, in an emergency, could be eaten uncooked. Each one-day pack of Horlicks food contained one 2.5-ounce vacuum-packed block of oatmeal, one 2.81-ounce tin of Holsteiner meat paste, or Spam paste, one 2-ounce vacuum pack of cheese, two 2-ounce envelopes of Materne fruit bars, 2.75-ounce envelopes of Enerzade glucose tablets, 1.75-ounce packet of Horlicks tablets, one 2.5-ounce vacuum-packed meat vegetable bar, three varieties, beef, mutton, and steak and kidney, one 2-ounce envelope of potato powder or rice, 45 packs contained potato powder, and 45 contained rice, one 0.5-ounce polythylene bag of salt, two 3-ounce vacuum packs of biscuits, two tea bags, one 1-ounce envelope of instant skim milk powder, one 2-ounce envelope of glucose lemon drink powder, one 1.25-ounce envelope of Horlicks chocolate powder, two envelopes of instant coffee, and 6 cubes of sugar. Supposedly, this supplied a balanced diet while being tasty enough. The total weight of the rations was relatively light, and it would all be easy to cook and stow. But if Fairfax at times during his voyage became a bit ambivalent about his boat, he would grow downright bad-tempered about the Horlicks food. It meant eating exactly the same things, day in and day out, for 100 days. By the second week of his voyage, John grasped what he called the appalling implications of this sameness. Archie de Jong had warned John that he would probably hate his guts long before the trip was over, and although he did not come to hate Archie, he quickly learned to detest his food. John Fairfax had hoped that, by his 117th day at sea, he and Britannia would be well past the 70-degree line of west longitude, breezing past the islands of Turks and Caicos, and quickly approaching the Bahamas. From there, the distance to Miami would be only 500 to 600 miles. At a rate of 40 miles per day, he could make Florida in 2 weeks or less. That would put him safely on land by June 1, the official start to the Atlantic and Caribbean hurricane season. It had always been Fairfax's plan to beat any possibility of getting caught in one of the early summer's violent tropical storms. But Fairfax was nowhere close to the West Indies, let alone the Bahamas. Nor was he anywhere close to being past 70 degrees west longitude. His position on May 17, the day that Tom McClean, unknown to John, started his Atlantic trek from St. John's, was 22 degrees 54 minutes north and 54 degrees 46 minutes west. Those coordinates meant that Britannia was still over 1,500 miles from Miami, three times farther than he wanted to be. What had happened to slow down Fairfax? His voyage had started smoothly enough. Taking the advice of local fishermen, he had arranged for Britannia to be towed down from Las Palmas on the north side of Gran Canaria, some 35 miles to the beachside village of San Agustin on the southeast coast. Leaving from San Agustin with the benefit of a light southwesterly breeze behind her, Britannia, even plodding along at a two-knot pace, managed to round the Maspalomas lighthouse at the southern tip of the island within a few hours. So content was Fairfax with the comfortable start to his journey that, in the hot sun of the early afternoon, he decided to have a little rest. A kind soul had dropped a long-necked bottle of beer on deck just as he pushed off from San Agustin. It was a bottle of Tropical Premium, the beer of choice on Gran Canaria, brewed in Las Palmas, and noted for its amber color and taste of butterscotch and malt. To be on our own at last, thought John, called for a celebration. He drank his fill of the tasty beer and let Britannia have the dregs. For the next few hours, John took a siesta, simply letting the boat drift. By late afternoon, they had skimmed along enough, with little rowing, to clear the island. As sunset approached, the wind increased to force 3 and then to force 4, still coming from the southwest, but accelerating to between 8 and 17 miles per hour. According to the Beaufort scale, that range indicated a moderate breeze. Created by British Admiral Sir Francis Beaufort, 1774 to 1857, in 1805, the Beaufort scale was one of the first scales to estimate wind speeds and their effects. Beaufort developed the scale to help sailors estimate the winds via visual observations. The scale starts with 0 and goes to a force of 12. The Beaufort scale is still used today to estimate wind strengths. With small waves starting to crest and break as whitecaps, known to sailors as white horses, John decided to shift Britannia onto a northwesterly course, thereby keeping the waves more or less abeam, that was, at a right angle to the fore-to-aft line of his boat. It was the best of a bad choice, John wrote in his log. It was John's first awareness of just how grossly overloaded his boat was, weighing, as it did at the start of the trip, over 2,000 pounds. But to get into the trade winds, John couldn't let Britannia wander too far north. He needed to make her run on a southerly course. As the wind increased in force and started to move on her bows, Britannia did not adjust well to the new course. In his log, John described this as our first clash of wills, with the boat's will mostly winning. Bending to the oars with all I had, sweating, cursing, changing the position of the daggerboard, trailing a warp, pulling on the port oar alone. Try as I might, I could not make her change her mind. Eventually, so drained out I could not even spit, I had to surrender. Britannia insisted that if she was going to head anywhere, it would be either southeast or northwest. She loved being broadside to the weather. John's main concern was getting as far away from the Canaries as possible. If the boat drifted to the northwest, there were other islands out there: Tenerife, La Gomera, El Hierro, and La Palma. The last thing he wanted was to crash in the middle of the night into a rocky shoreline. So very slow had Britannia's progress been during its first day on the sea that John, looking over his shoulder, could still see the dark, rugged silhouette of Grand Canary on the rear horizon. He guessed that Britannia was no more than 15 miles from piling up on its cliffs. If the wind somehow switched to a westerly, that would become a real threat. Highly frustrated, Fairfax wondered, "How on earth have I got myself into this mess?" Already he was aching, tired, and fed up. Uffa Fox's design of the rowboat was undeniably excellent. Ocean water was shipping into her by the bucketful, but Britannia's ingenious self-draining system was working to perfection. That didn't stop John from getting wet, however, nor did it make it any easier for him to row through the choppy backs of 5 and 6 foot waves. By the second day of the voyage, John was already thinking he might be better off dumping overboard at least a third of his stores, lightening the boat's weight, and rely more on catching fish for food. If Britannia wasn't so damn heavy, he would have a better chance going in the direction that he wanted, west. Also, as quickly as possible, he wanted to get out of the shipping lane that ran along the African coast. Britannia had no navigation lights. All John had to show himself to approaching ships was the glow of a rather powerful flashlight he had brought aboard for that purpose, but with a limited number of batteries. To obviate the chances of getting hit, most likely fatally, by a ship, Fairfax settled on staying awake and rowing almost nonstop throughout the night and sleeping during the day. A change of the wind to a northeasterly on day 3 made his rowing much easier. On his 5th day, January 25, however.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.